Going live in 5, 4, 3.
Good morning. We'd like to thank you and welcome you all for coming to church service this morning. Let us all be at peace and be with God as we open up with the with our gathering today. Gather to worship together. Different people, different times, different histories. Yet all children of the same parent.
Created of the source of all life.
We gather to reconnect with one another.
Different people, different lives, different histories.
Yet all disciples of one teacher.
Jesus is the word made flesh, dwelling among us.
We gather with different joys and sorrows, with different hopes and fears.
Different people, different lives, different nations.
Yet one people, with one God, one faith, one baptism.
Let us open ourselves to the presence of God around us, among us, and through us.
Let us all say together in unison the prayer of confession. We are workers, God, just like you, but we confess that our actions cannot offer and honor each other. Our work is not always done in the spirit that is pleasing to you. We confess that on some occasions we have blindly brought the goods paid to good people, or are paid too little, or work needs. We admit that we have failed to end our justice in which some workers have jobs that provide good wages and benefits, while others may have no jobs, one that pays little that provides food benefits. Creator God, help us to be people working for a world where all workers are valued, a world where those who clean houses are able to buy houses together, a world where those who grow food can also afford to eat their fill, and one whose goods serve and care for others, stores, schools, restaurants, nursing homes, and many other places, but themselves cared for. It will be a cold world where all workers everywhere share in the lives that you have given us.
Join me in the word of worship. Our God is a God of grace and grants permission. When we ask God gives us the courage and strength to go without our faith in the workplace, in the marketplace, as well as in the sanctuary.
I want to see. Yeah, I'll share a lot about what's been going on in my life later on, but I want to thank you. It is an honor to be here, an honor to be in this community. Yeah, so I was sitting that way, and I was facing this way, and I like that they asked for prayer requests, but I know I have one written down, but we might not always have a chance to write them down, so I was wondering if you all have any prayer requests. Three. Yeah, I love those songs, especially Open Eyes in My Heart. What a great prayer that we may see God and see God glorified. And I think that has been my prayer lately, turning my heart's attention back to God. And I have everyday concerns. I, lose parents, whatever, all that stuff. But I don't want to say that it pales in comparison to the glory of God, but it does. And that's, so as we turn to God in prayer, I want to acknowledge that we all have concerns of our heart, things in our life that are going on that nobody else knows about, and thoughts that we have that are only between us and God. And I want to say that God will meet that, and God will ask God to come to this space. So join me in prayer. God, we come to you. As you come to us in this space, in this sanctuary, Lord, that we may offer our time and attention to you, and that you will wrap your arms of love and care around us. God, we all have concerns. We all have things that weigh on our hearts and our minds, and things that we can't do anything about. But God, we know that you hear us, and you love us, and you are more than able to meet all of our needs. And God, we turn our attention to you. For everybody who is affected by the wildfires in Maui, Lord, it doesn't just stop on that island or this island or this state, but specifically, we grieve with the people, and we ask for you to meet our pain. For the children who are going back to school this week, that in the midst of this unthinkable circumstance that they have to do the impossible. And with that, we ask for a sense of normalcy. We ask for a sense of relief. But we also ask that your love would pour forth to the teachers and the people involved with bringing the students back. Lord, as we celebrate Labor Day, a holiday that we made up, but is still in celebration of the work that we do. Because we toil and we work. And we work for your glory. And celebrate it as an opportunity to share the love that you have for us. So God, for all of these concerns, we ask that you would meet us. May we focus on you. In your name, amen.
The morning scripture is taken from the book of Matthew, chapter 6. Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And wherever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go to your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because at their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Pray then in this way: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. For you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. This is the good news.
So the last time I had the opportunity to be here was Communion Sunday in July, and I forgot to say the Lord's Prayer. So to make up for my mistake, I thought that I would dedicate this entire message to the Lord's Prayer. I'm sorry for forgetting it. So first, will you join me in prayer? God, I ask that you would help me to step aside so that you may be known in you alone, that any words that I say that might distract or might not be of you will be forgotten, Lord, and that you will be our focus. Amen. So I was going through one of my friend's Instagram feeds this week, and it was really interesting. So he works on the national staff of the United Church of Christ, and it was just basically, it was an expletive, then comma, then God. You know, saying, this is a prayer. Because it is an honest expression of what is on his heart, of what he's thinking. And I said, I don't know. Yes, prayers can be simple. Prayers can be as simple as, God, we love you. Thank you for loving us. Prayers can be as simple as be with my wife, be with my family. It could be as simple as be with Luke. Prayers don't have to be anything complex. Prayers can be very simple, because that is the relationship that God has with us. It's very intimate. We're known. There's nothing profound that we have to say. But God just wants to know what is on our hearts. So this is what's been happening in my life. For the past month, since the end of July, I've been on suspension from the Army. I don't know how much to reveal, but in full disclosure and honesty, so my relationship with my girlfriend is considered to be illegal, just because of the Uniform Code of Military Justice, because her divorce is not finalized. She just had to send in a piece of paper. Her husband has not lived on an island since 2018. They've been separated since 2014. By all accounts, it is a relationship that I believe that honors God. The Army doesn't see it that way. And so they said, hey, conduct unbecoming of an officer, we're going to suspend you and place you under investigation. It's been weighing heavily on my heart. in my mind and my soul, and for the past month, I can say that when people ask me like how I'm doing, I say good, because who wants to know the full story? But honestly, like I am awful. You know, I love the military, I love the army. I would never do anything to jeopardize that or hurt that or hurt Michaela or Luke or anybody who's personally involved with this. But most of all, I feel bad for my soldiers because they've been without a chaplain for the past couple months and maybe. And I want to see God glorified. And I want this all to work out how I want it to work out. But I'm not God. And God might have different plans or different ideas, and who knows. But that is the great thing about prayer, is that I can give all these thoughts and worries and anxieties over to God, and to know that God loves me. So while things in life might not work out how I want them to, I can trust that this is a part of God's will. And I don't exactly know what that means, and that causes a lot of questions for me, but I can always say, turn to prayer and find some comfort in that. I want to recognize that tomorrow's Labor Day, a day where we celebrate work. I have been blessed to be in the position of an officer in the Army for the past couple of years, and I love it. And it comes with a lot of privileges, and it is something that I love. But I know that we all don't have the privilege of doing work that we love, or work that we feel valued for. Or my grandmother, Margaret Alice, my dad's mom, worked in one of the hotels in Waikiki for 30 plus years, and she was far more talented than a housekeeper, but she did work that was righteous. She honored God with her sacrifice for her family, and she worked diligently, and I thank God for that. So we might be teachers, we might be, who knows, but whatever we do, I pray that tomorrow we may celebrate work and labor and remember that we don't work for ourselves, we work for our families, we work for God. The work that we do matters and it's important. So prayer. So all week I've been listening to the Lord's Prayer in song form, actually the past month I have. Matt Mayer, if you have YouTube, whatever, if you have the internet, Matt Mayer does a great version of the Lord's Prayer song. And I thought that I would go through the Lord's Prayer just because I did not do it in July. And I'd like to do it today. So, and apply it to my life, because I'll be selfish and say that I've prayed this prayer thousands of times a day. So, it starts, Our Father in Heaven. And I'll stop there because I struggle with calling God Father. I love my father. I love my dad. He is a great person. It's been a struggle for me to see God as male, to see God as female, to see God as anything but loving. So I understand it's written in the Bible, in the ancient Greek, just as masculine, and father as a term of reverence. But whenever I think of God, honestly, I think of my grandmother, Sharon, my mom's mom. She's like the most godly woman, and she's been the most Christ-like person in my life. So I understand words have meaning, language has meaning. I personally, whenever I think of God, I don't think of male, I don't think of female, I don't think of a person, I think of God. And I think of the people who love me, and that is most closely seen in my grandmother. So whatever we call God, whether that's father, whether that's mother, whether that's auntie, uncle, grandfather, grandmother, know that it comes from a place of love. So, hallowed be your name. Hallowed is very, I don't know, not a word we use, but it means we bring reverence to you. We bring you the honor and glory to your name. We offer our lives in worship as to to your glory, your majesty. We want to make God known, and we want to make God exalted. And I think that that is a great prayer, just to say that, God, I want to see you glorified. I want to see you in my life. I want to see you in circumstances. So, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Nope, sorry, skipped a part. Made another mistake. Your kingdom come. So when I think of God's kingdom, I remove the G and I say kingdom. Because to me, I see God at work in people. I see God at work in community. I see God at work in the relationships that we have. So kin, the word for people, because I have an easier time understanding God's kingdom whenever I see it lived out, whenever I see it in a church, whenever I see it in, family, whenever I see it, God's love being expressed. And for me, that's in kingdom. So kingdom, I think it's synonymous, but different words for different types of things. So however we see God's kingdom, God's glory, the majesty of heaven, how we see it revealed on earth, because I'm also a very practical person. So I see it in relationship, I see it in kingdom. So on earth as it is in heaven, it's hard to imagine heaven. For me, personally, it's hard to imagine heaven. I grew up in Sunday school. I grew up with my mom reading me Bible stories. I know the vision of heaven, of angels and clouds and harps and golden roads, and I don't know what heaven is. I don't know what happens after we depart from this earth. I believe there's an afterlife, and I believe that we go to a place where God's love surrounds us and we are able to fully see God. And I hope for that on earth as I hope for that in heaven, to be able to see God and to know God. And I think that that is the greatest thing that I can set my mind on right now, because everything else is kind of blurry. It's fuzzy, it's out of focus. I don't know what to think at the moment, but I know that I can turn my focus and my heart and my attention to God, and God's in heaven, and put my hope in that. So give us this day our daily bread. So whenever I told my parents about this, their first question to me was, "You're still getting paid, right?" I was like, "Yeah, I'm still getting paid. I still put on a uniform every day. I still go to work. Work is a little different. It's a lot different, but yeah, my needs are met. I'm working. I'm getting a paycheck. I can't really honestly say that I'm earning a paycheck, but I'm getting a paycheck. I see it as my daily bread. It is meant for me, it's meant for Luke, it's meant for bills, whatever, the things of this earth that we have concerns about. My daily bread is being met, and I thank God for that, because Hawaii is an expensive place. And without whatever might come, whatever might happen, if the army is removed, then getting daily bread will be a lot more difficult. Not impossible, but a lot more difficult. And I thank God for the daily bread that's provided. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And this is a difficult one, I'll be honest. So, So I opened my big mouth. That's how all this started. I have a big mouth. And I say things that I shouldn't say. I reveal things that I shouldn't reveal. And somebody was like, "Hey, that's a red flag. We have to start something now." So for a long time, I've harbored bitterness and resentment against this person who was initiating all of this. And I thought, man, that person, they put a kick up in life, and I feel like they have sinned against me. Whether they see it that way or not, I don't know. I'm guessing they don't. But I have to say to God, forgive this person, because I forgive them. Forgive me for harboring these feelings of resentment, because that's not what you want for your kingdom. That's not what you want for unity amongst your people. It was similar to, this was 2020, in the middle of COVID, and I was thinking about my relationship with Marcy, with Luke's mom, and I thought, well, I have to forgive her. I have to forgive her for my perception of the things that she did wrong. And totally, listen, I know you don't like me. I know that I've caused you a lot of pain, and I ask for forgiveness. Not so that you will grant forgiveness to me, because I don't know if I deserve that, but I deserve to forgive myself. And it brought me peace. It brought me closure. And I think that salvation kind of works in a similar way, because we confess our sins before God, and we ask for the love of Christ to fill us. It's a recognition that we've turned away from God, that we've done things in our lives that bring dishonor to God, and we say, we're sorry. I think we do this every day, intentionally or unintentionally. I think that we grieve others, we hurt others. We don't live up to the glory of God. And for that, we have to say we're sorry. I have to say that I'm sorry to all of you for bringing this to you. But this is a concern in my heart. And I hope that you will forgive me. So the next line is, do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. Well, let's go. Do not bring us to the time of trial. And some versions say, Lord, lead us not into temptation. This is hotly debated about whether God actually leads us into temptation, about whether the trials that we face in life are from God. Because we think about Job. Job was, God didn't cause those trials for Job. That was Satan. God allowed that to happen. He said, have you considered my servant Job? But the bad things, the obstacles that come into our lives don't come from God. At least I don't believe they come from God. This came on because I opened my big mouth, as I said earlier, because they didn't use wisdom or discretion or discernment. And so the line of this prayer causes me to question. I don't know what it means. I'll be honest, but what I do know is that God won't tempt us, that God won't bring ill into our lives, which stirs a whole bunch of theological questions and debates, but at the end of the day, I know that God loves me, and that's what I rest with. But rescue me from the evil one. So, evil exists in the world. I don't know how. I don't know if Satan is real. I don't know these things. But I know that evil exists in the world. Because nobody has to teach a child to say no. A child just says no. And whatever that means, whatever that does, I know that evil exists. And I know that something is trying to be worked out that will remove me from something that I love. And while I see that as evil, yeah, I will. Because I don't think that this is what God wants. So I have to trust that God will prevail, and I have to have faith, because things happen in life all the time that we might attribute to evil, we might attribute to Satan, we might say a whole bunch of things. But at the end of the day, we have to have faith. Not faith that things will work out how we want them to, but faith that we are loved by God, loved by our loved ones, loved by our community, friends, all of that. in that to live a life that is brings glory to God is the best thing that we can do. So in the native part, so I would always forget this because when I was working hospice, I had a lot of people who were Catholic, and they never, that's not a thing in the Catholic Church, the last part. I'm gonna forget what it is right now. So, for now is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Because they say that's not in the Bible, that's just something we added. I don't know. But it's good words, and they're a good ending, and it's a good way to say, we have to say amen. So as I prepare to say amen, and we go and transition into the communion service, I want the Lord's Prayer to not be something that we say out of rote memorization, or something that we say because that was the first prayer that we learned, or because even Jesus says to pray it. But to say it as a way that we live our lives, to say it out of worship, to say it as in ingrained, I've been struggling with this word all week, as something that lives within us, that we take with us, and as we walk down the hallways of school, as we go to the beach, as we run errands, things that we constantly keep on our mind and our heart and stay in communion with God. Because a lot of times that will be the hope that we have. That might be our only hope. That might be the only thing that brings us joy or comfort. And if that's true, then that's amazing, because that is intimacy with God. That is the relationship with God. And I don't think that we can pray for anything better. So yes, we have concerns, we have things on our hearts and our minds, and those are good things. And those things come from God. So as we say amen, we know that that's not the end. We say that that is a pause, and we can continue with our relationship with God and God's love for us. So yeah, let's move into the communion service.
Jesus said, I am the bread of life. You who come to me shall not hunger. You who believe in me shall never thirst. In company with all those who hunger in spiritual food, we come to this table to know the risen Christ and the sharing of this life-giving bread. In Luke's gospel, Jesus sat with two of the disciples and was known to them in the breaking of the bread. This table is for all believers who wish to know the presence of Christ and to share the community of God's people.
What a joy and honor that we have to share communion with each other, communion with God. I was doing a baptism yesterday, and I said out of the official things of Mary, Mary, and baptized was my favorite, but communion is great. It is togetherness. It is the kingdom of God. So, join me in this prayer. Holy God, we praise and bless you for creation and the gift of life, and for your abiding love, which brings us close to you, the source of all blessing. We thank you for revealing your will for us in the giving of the law and in the preaching of the prophets. We thank you, especially that in the fullness of time you sent Jesus, born of Mary, to live in our midst, to share in our suffering, and to accept the pain of death at the hands of those whom Jesus loved. We rejoice that in a perfect victory over the grave, you raised Christ with power to become sovereign in your realm. We celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit to gather your church, that which your work may be done in the world, and through which we share the gift of eternal life with the faithful in every time and place. We praise with joy your holy name. Holy, 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 God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God. Hosanna in the highest. We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, Jesus also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink. Drink it in remembrance of me." Consecrate, therefore, by your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine, and bless us that as we receive them at this table, we may offer you our faith and pride and praise. We may be united with Christ and with one another, and we may continue faithful in all things. In the strength Christ gives us, we offer ourselves to you, Eternal God. He gives thanks that you have called us to serve you. We now say the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, in the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So we have these, so the bread and the cup. So I invite you to partake with me.
In unison, say the prayer of thanksgiving. God of heaven and earth, we make your name great as we worship you with our lives. Thank you for the bread and the cup and the communion that we have with you and each other. We thank you for your presence, love, and blessings. We honor you. Amen. Now at this time we'll have our morning offering. Will the usher please come forward with this morning offering? special offering from Kristen Andres to the Sherwin Gubashio Scholarship Fund. Wildlife Relief Fund from Sandra Sakai-Sai. Wild Relief Fund from Shane Zalong. Birthday offering from Golden Pato from Marvin Calloway and Tobu. And a birthday and memorial offering for Alyssa Yamanomochi from the Andres Mahama.
God, for these offerings, for the work that you will do with them, for Maui, for birthplace, for memorials. God, we thank you for being in our lives and for loving us. In your name, amen.
Okay, just a few announcements before we end our service today. I'd like to thank you, Pastor Vance, for being our guest preacher today. Tuesday market will be closed in August and will resume on September 12th. Wednesday Bible study is also operating and will resume on September 20th. And for those of you that shop at Foodland, don't forget to give aloha campaign. Write it down. The number to donate to is 77136. That's for the Waialua United Church of Christ. Also, those of you who want to donate to the Wildfire Relief Fund on Maui, Hawaii Conference Office has set up a relief fund in which individuals may contribute. We are collecting any donations and forwarding it to the conference on behalf of Waialua United Church of Christ. If you make a monetary or you write a check, please annotate on your check that it is for the Wildlife Relief Funds. Also, a calendar of events. Tomorrow is Labor Day. Sunday, September 10th, our altar flowers will be from the Ramones family. Worship leader will be Rosemary Basilio. It is also Grandparents Day, so if you have grandparents, give them a hug. Finance meeting. Sunday, September 17th will be council meeting, and Sunday, September 24th is the property team meeting. Is there any other announcements from the floor?
Good morning, all. I just wanted to recap on the two announcements that was made. The Give Aloha campaign has started, our annual fundraising campaign. The maximum you can donate is $249, and don't remember to turn in your receipts upon doing that donation for your pledges. You can credit your pledges. Also, the next item was on the Hawaii Conference Relief Fund, the Wildfire Relief Fund. We were notified that we'll be collecting your donations if you want to give. Just make sure that you have the check or made out to Waialua United Church of Christ, and we in turn will forward all your donations as a pledge for the relief fund to the organizations. Always encouraged, because one of our sister churches was part of that disastrous fire that plagued Lahaina. So, thank you.
If there are no other announcements, shall we all rise for the final closing hymn? Here I am, Lord.
I have heard of you, my God, all of friends.
as we are sent from this place, I ask that God will go with us and that we will do our best to bring glory to God in the knowledge that God loves us. Amen.